Well, let's all lift the name of the Lord up this morning. Let's feel free to everybody come up and let's just worship. Lord Jesus, Lord, we thank you, Lord. Lord, just take over the service, Lord. Lord, we love you so much, Lord, and help us just to go to another level in you, Lord. In Jesus' name, Lord, just flow through here in Jesus' name. Amen. Y'all come on up.
care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are.
Oh, wait. Lord Jesus, I ask, as I talk about what I'm going to today, Lord, I ask that you give me the words. And Lord, let us be led by your Holy Spirit, Lord. In Jesus' name, and help me to say it in such a way, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's turn to Genesis 6. We had a deliverance team come up here last week. And the Lord really moved. And I'm going to read something here. It's in 6 and 4. It said, there were giants on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and they bore children to them, those who were the mighty men, who were of old, men of renown. Okay. That was, when I got to looking at that, Hope was talking about in the book of Enoch, it says that these creatures, when they mated with the daughters of men, these was hybrids, and they was real evil. And that's when God brought the flood. And but it said afterwards, so their spirit, when they died, their spirit went out, but their spirit can't be redeemed, so it couldn't go back to heaven, so it's loose on the earth. So that's what demons are. Now, this is just a theory of I'm just saying. If you want, I mean, I ain't going to, you know, I'm just telling you what this is, what I've read about this, but the thing is, I know for a fact demons are real. Whether they come from that, whether they come from this or that, I know they're demonic entities that are real, and I've seen them. I mean, I've seen them manifested. I hadn't seen through people, and I've felt it come on me. And if you'll think about it, all of us have felt it come on us. Have you ever got so angry you wanted to choke somebody or hurt them? You know, that's a spirit of anger, and it comes on us. And then there's also spirits of other false religions and stuff. Okay, let's look. I'm going to turn to, let's look at Matthew 8:28. This is Jesus. I'm going to start at 8:28. It says, when he had come to the other side, to the country of the Gergesians, there met him two demon-possessed men coming out of the tombs, exceedingly fierce, so that no one could pass that way. And suddenly they cried out, saying, what have we to do with you, Jesus, you Son of God? Have you come here to torment us before our time? Now, a good way off from them, there was a herd of many swine feeding. So the demons begged him, saying, if you can cast us out, permit us to go away into the herd of swine. And he said to them, go. So when they had come out, they went into the herd of swine, and suddenly the whole herd of swine ran violently down in a steep place into the sea and perished in the water. Then those who kept them fled, and they went away into the city and told everything, including what had happened to the demon-possessed men. Behold, the whole city came out to meet Jesus, and when they saw him, they begged him to depart from their region. Okay. I've read that, and I've always thought, well, pigs couldn't swim. Pigs can swim. I've seen it. You pull it up on, there's someplace down the ocean, them pigs, they've got to turn, you swim with the pigs. And I got to thinking about that, and I thought, them pigs committed suicide. When that thing came on them, they committed suicide. So it's kind of like, have you ever thought about suicidal thoughts? In other words, I have in the past, and it's kind of like you, when you realize this is a spirit speaking to you, you take authority over it. You got authority over this in the name of Jesus if you're a born-again Christian. These are things, look how they did when Jesus told them to go. But what I got to thinking about, this is what I've been thinking about, and I'm going to talk about today. Let's turn to Exodus.
32. A long time ago, we went to on a trip, Jeff and us, and we went out to in the Grand Canyon area, and there was people started manifesting with demons. And it's like a bunch of them, there's 12 people at one church, just about a whole bunch of them started manifesting. And I had always, I started reading this book. Well, I went and bought this book, and it was about this thick on deliverance. And I remember Danny Joe Seal was still alive, and he said, "My goodness, that's bigger than the Bible." And when he said that, it kind of made me feel guilty. I thought, here I am searching everything about a devil when he's give us his word, how much he loves us, and he gives us authority to cast them out. He didn't tell us how to go hang out with them, how to be buddies with them, and all this stuff. He just said, cast them out. But I'm going to look here as, let me get back to my scripture, Exodus 32. This is when Moses, he went up on the mountain and got the Ten Commandments. And I'm gonna just read it. Starting at 32 and 1, Exodus. "Now when the people saw that Moses delayed coming down from the mountain, the people gathered around to Aaron and said to him, 'Come, make us gods that shall go before us, for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him.' And Aaron said to him, 'Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives and your sons and your daughters, and bring them to me.' So all the people broke off the golden earrings which were there in their ears and brought them to Aaron. And he received the gold from their hand, and he fashioned it with an engraved tool and made a molded calf. Then they said, 'This is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt.'" And it's making a false god. Here it is, God's lighting up the whole mountain. God the Creator, he's up there with Moses. He created everything. He brought him. He split the Red Sea. And they're saying, "Well, let's melt something down here and make it." And can you imagine how that hurt God's feelings? Wouldn't that hurt? You know what I'm saying? Kind of like he loved them and he got a plan for you. Okay? And it said, "This is our God, O Israel, that brought us out of the land of Egypt." So when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made a proclamation and said, "Tomorrow is a feast to the Lord," which is making a false god. "Then they rose early on the next day, offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. And the Lord said to Moses, 'Go down, for your people whom you brought out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made themselves a molded calf and worshipped and sacrificed to it and said, "This is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt." And the Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people. Indeed, it is a stiff-necked people. Now, therefore, let me alone that my wrath may burn hot against them and I may consume them and I will make you a great nation." He's saying, I'm fixing to kill them. In other words, here it is. They're sitting here looking at me up here, and then they go to making some kind of false god. That hurts God's feelings. He's real. We don't want to hurt his feelings. Now, this is where it's kind of going to shift a little bit. Let's turn to Samuel, 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel 28. First Samuel 28, and we'll start at 7. "Then Saul said to the servants, 'Find me a woman who is a medium. Now, this is Saul that was king. God had anointed him king, but then he kept on doing everything going against God. So, long story short, God finally rejected him and says, "Make David. I'm going to make David my king." So, here it is. He quit hearing the voice of the Lord. Samuel had died, and he was wanting to hear from God, but he was wanting to hear from Samuel. So here it is. He twists everything around, goes, and then he says, "Find me a medium that might go to her and inquire of her." And this servant said to him, "In fact, there is a woman who is a medium at Endor," which is a witch, or a fortune teller. So Saul disguised himself and put on other clothes, and he went, and two men with him. And they came to the woman by night, and he said, "Please conduct a seance for me and bring up for me the one I shall name to you." Then the woman said to him, "Look, you know what Saul has done, how he has cut off the mediums and the spirits from the land. Why then do you lay a snare for my life to cause me to die?" And Saul swore by the Lord, saying, "As the Lord lives, no punishment shall come upon you for this thing." And the woman said, "Whom shall I bring up for you?" And he said, "I'll bring up Samuel for me." And when the woman saw Samuel, she cried out with a loud voice. And the woman spoke to Saul, saying, "Why have you deceived me? For you are Saul." And the king said to her, "Do not be afraid. What do you see?" And the woman said to Saul, "I saw a spirit ascending out of the earth." So he said to her, "What is his form?" And she said, "An old man is coming up, and he is covered with a mantle." And Saul perceived that it was Samuel, stood up in his face, with his face to the ground, and bowed down. Now Samuel said to Saul, "Why have you disturbed me by bringing me up?" And Saul answered, "I am deeply distressed, for the Philistines war against me, and God has departed from me and does not answer me anymore, neither by prophet nor by dreams. Therefore I shall have called you that you may reveal to me what I should do." And Samuel said, "So why do you ask me, seeing that the Lord has departed from you and has become your enemy, and the Lord has done for himself as he spoke by me? For the Lord has torn the kingdom from you in your hand and given it to your neighbor David, because you did not obey the voice of the Lord nor execute his fierce wrath upon the Amalek. Therefore the Lord has done this thing to you. Moreover, the Lord will also deliver Israel with you into the hand of the Philistines. And tomorrow, you and your sons will be with me. The Lord will also deliver the army of the Philistines into the hand of the Philistines." He told me, "Well, you're going to die tomorrow." That always, I remember hearing that when I was a kid, somebody preaching about it. And that always kept me from going to a fortune teller. And the reason being, it wasn't that I was afraid of the fortune teller. I was afraid of God. Because he don't want you going to one. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, I thought, man, you know, it was, you know, a lot of people look at it certain ways. He just told them what was going to happen. He died the next day. Okay. Let's look at Deuteronomy 18. Look at 10. "There shall not be found among you anyone who makes his son or daughter to pass through the fire, or one who practices witchcraft, or a soothsayer, or one who interprets omens, or a sorcerer, or one who conjures spells, or a medium, or a spiritualist, or one who calls up the dead. For all who do these things are an abomination to the Lord." An abomination, it makes him sick. He can't stand it. It tears him up. In other words, it's kind of like if you've ever been cheated on in a past relationship or whatever, it's kind of like you're going and cheating with the devil. Now, I've seen this guy named John Ramirez. He was into this witchcraft stuff and everything. I started to show a video of him, and it took a long time. But he was talking about, we don't want to cheat on Jesus. We don't want to cheat on him. That's what we do when we go to do this stuff. And you think, man, What's wrong with a horoscope? Don't do it. He commanded us not to do it. And have you ever noticed? Have you all noticed how the witchcraft and it's Halloween, getting here, Halloween and everything, how everything looks real demonic? I mean, it's always been that way. But me and Hope went over to a store over there, a bookstore over in Tupelo, and they had all kind of books. But everywhere I'd look, I'd see something about witchcraft. Witchcraft. So here I was, I'd see one, so I'd turn it around, put it where nobody couldn't see it. I called them a lot of work, everybody's working over there. But then I got over there to this one section, and it was like books, books, and then you had another roll of book. The whole section was about witchcraft. I thought, I'm going to be over here all day turning books around. Thought, this beats all I have ever seen. And I didn't realize how much, I mean, they must be selling this stuff or people wouldn't be doing it. You take Harry Potter. Okay, and you think, well, I can holler Harry Potter all day. This stuff started a long time ago. Even back when we went to Disney World, they had the thing with Mickey Mouse, had a little stick. Dude casting some kind of spell in 1930. You know what I'm saying? They're like, well, that's just little Mickey. No, it's demonic. You know what I'm saying? And I didn't realize this. I thought, you know, and I've been the first one to say, there ain't nothing wrong with somebody going and, you know, doing something on Halloween. I've said it. I've thought it. And even when I didn't say it, you know what I'm saying? But I've changed my mind on it. This stuff's demonic. These devils are coming out, and it's kind of like you think, well, how are you opening the door? Okay, movies. Take bad movie. Okay, a scary movie. I remember The Exorcist came out back in the 70s. I was just a kid, and the commercial come on TV, and I thought, what on earth is that? And I was sitting there, and this music was going, or something crazy, some little music on the piano. Did you know? I had nightmares from that, just seeing that little commercial on the TV. This is real. These are demonic spirits, and they'll go through a TV, and it's kind of like, well, ain't nothing wrong with watching a little scary movie. And then the next thing, you're afraid to even go to Walmart, afraid somebody's chasing you. This stuff is real. You know what I'm saying? Somebody's trying to get me. They're going to rob me. People are going to get shot, you know, and all that somebody's trying to do. Say, hey, I just hunt my keys. I wasn't trying to bother you. You know what I'm saying? I'm telling you, this stuff is real. And these demonic spirits are real. And I remember, and I was thinking about Halloween and stuff. And I thought, well, you know, and I was talking to Hope this morning. I was like, well, what about somebody that they're going to take their kids trick-or-treating and everything? Hope's like, You don't want to hear what I got to say about it. And I said, what? Well, she let me have it. Because, see, Hope had got into some stuff back years ago. Way before we ever got together, she got into some occult stuff. And then these demonic things were starting. She'd wake up smothering like she couldn't get up. And that's when she come to the Lord and she started realizing, even though she'd been in church her whole life, then she didn't realize she'd opened the door to these demons. She'd hear stuff walking down the house and she'd hear these sounds of this stuff. And he's like, and then one time it said, this is your mom. And she said, no, mom's dead. And she started hearing this stuff and she was hearing this stuff. Well, she went to her people in the military where she's at. Well, then they sent her to mental health. She went to the preacher. He sent her to mental health. She went and talked to these people and said, what's going on? And they wouldn't nobody tell her, these are demons. This stuff is trying to kill you. You know, and then so she said she was riding down the road. She thought, well, I don't want to kill myself, but I'm going crazy. I can't say she got to where she's afraid to even sleep. And I might be telling this a little wrong, but I'll have her share it sometime. But she said, finally, she said, what am I missing? And didn't even say God or nothing or anything else. And said the Lord spoke to her, said, you're missing me. And exactly, she knew it was Jesus. And she knew that she needed to cry out to him. And he felt and said, Lord. And she said, there's this guy give her a Bible in the military. And she said, Lord, I don't know how to do all this, but I want what he's got. Because she said he talked to Jesus like he was right in the car with him or on the phone with him. She said, I want what he's got. I want it for real. And said the presence of God came down and boom, touched her. Never had no more encounters like that from that point on. Yeah. We open the door. We open the door when we start. I was thinking about the children of Israel. Okay. Here it is, and this come out to me this morning when I was reading that. Moses goes up there. He's on the mountain. And then Joshua comes down. Hey, they're having a party. He tells Moses. He went up with Moses. He said, they're having a big party. Now all this stuff is going on. And it's like, and then God's getting all tore up because, hey, they're making a gold calf out of something. And then Aaron's like, oh, I just throwed all that stuff in there and it came out, you know. And I always laughed about that. I thought, well, you know, how Aaron was. And I thought, when we've done it, and we've done it, and we thought we was doing it in the right thing, but let's not do Halloween no more. Nothing to do with it. You know what I'm saying? I remember one time we done something for the kids up here, and I was thinking, it's like when I was reading that about the children of Israel, and I thought, what if God were to come back right then? We was up there and everybody had their little suits on and everything. And he come to me and he said, I'd have been worse than Aaron. Well, that's how I wanted to do it for the kids. I'd have thrown y'all under the bus. I'm telling you. I can't really pick at Aaron too much, but you know what I'm saying? But I thought, there's something, there's a new level of demonic come up. And I realized it this week. I don't know if it's cause of so much people opening the door to demonic stuff and everything. So if we want to get the kids candy, grab them a box of candy, throw them out there and just, hey, have at it. You know what I'm saying? Ain't got no money to get one. I'll buy you a sack. Throw it on the floor. And then we'll say, thank you, Jesus, for this candy. You know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? I want him happy. Don't y'all want him happy? He loves us so much. Believe me, I've thought a lot about this, and I thought about how am I going to talk about it, because I know this week is like all these kids and everything, and it's kind of like, but John Ramirez said, Anton LaVey, he said, thank the church. I want to thank the church, he said, because they give one day to Satan. Halloween. I want to thank them for dressing them up like ever how they want to. And then I started reading about when they dress people up in these stuff. And it's kind of like when you dress them up. You know what started that? It said, now I'm just reading history on the Googler, you know what I'm saying? But it said it started, these spirits would come up and they would put these masks and these uniforms, whatever you want to call them, and they'd put their stuff on and it would scare the spirits off. And then these jack-o'-lanterns, they would cut these things out, and that was supposed to run these evil spirits off. Well, I got news for you. That's going to open the door to them. It's kind of like whether Jesus had the door over the doorpost of the blood. That's kind of like putting the devil's, hey, they believe in the, they got a little something going on here. Now, if you've done this, believe me, I've been on both sides of the fence, and up till this week, I was debating whether I even get up here and talk about this, but I feel like it's something that we need to know, because I've seen how God set people free this week, and I've seen them getting touched right here. I'm telling you, it was amazing what God did, and I'm telling you, this is stuff that I don't know how the doors got opened. I don't know, but I'm just saying, let's shut them all. You know what I'm saying? I ain't even going to be looking at the fortune cookie at the Chinese restaurant. I mean, the other night when that guy was talking, Jordan turned around and looked at him and said, prophecy cookie. I thought, that no more. Oh, yeah, I said prophecy cookie. Yeah. I thought, well, I didn't want to call it a fortune cookie, but I thought, well, I was doing the same thing Aaron was. Well, we'll call it a prophecy cookie. What's it say? You know what I'm saying?
Not no more. Lord, forgive me for the prophecy cookie, Lord. I'm saying that, and you know what I'm saying? I just don't want no doors open. I don't want people getting tormented in their sleep. I don't want kids getting hurt in their feelings. You know what I'm saying? Or waking up scared with nightmares. I want them to say, wake up and say, hey, you get out of here in the name of Jesus. Let's look at something else here. Let's turn to Acts 19. I'm going to start at, let's read the one. Acts 19, and I'm going to start at 13. Somebody say, well, I always think about this one here a lot because, see right here. It said, then some of the itinerant Jews, exorcists, took it upon themselves to call the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, we exorcise you in the name of Jesus whom Paul preaches. Also there were seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest who did so. And the evil spirits answered and said, Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are you? Then the man in whom those evil spirits was leaped on them, overpowered them, and prevailed against them so that they fled out of the house naked and wounded. This became known both to all the Jews and the Greeks dwelling in Ephesus. And fear fell on them all, and the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. And many who had believed came confessing and telling their deeds. Also many of those who had practiced magic, listen to this, brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all. And they counted up the value of them and a total 50,000 pieces of silver. So the word of the Lord grew mightily and prevailed. They burn all this, their witchcraft stuff, all their books and all their stuff. If we do anything on Halloween, let's have a book burning. You know what I'm saying? It can be a soul tie burning. You know what I'm saying? If you're married to somebody and you got an old love letter from old Hoochie-Coo over yonder in the bushes, you know what I'm saying? Say, I'm breaking that soul tie, and I'm setting her on fire right here. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I'm telling you. We need to. But I want to look at this right here. Let's jump back at 19 and 1. It says, and it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus and finding some disciples, he said to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? So they said to him, we have not so much heard there is a Holy Spirit. And he said to them, into what were you baptized? And they said, into John's baptism. Then Paul said, John indeed baptized with the baptism of repentance, also saying to the people that they should believe in him who would come after him, that is on the Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. Now the men were about 12 in all. If we're going to seek something, us seek the Holy Ghost. He loves you. He's going to watch out for you. He's going to bring stuff to your remembrance. He's going to keep you from going down a road somewhere where you might get killed. He loves you. It's not nothing scary. It's not nothing bad. We need the Holy Ghost more than we ever have in our life. I'm telling you, we can't be opening the door to this demonic stuff. I'm telling you. This stuff's real. But you know who's more realer? Holy Ghost. Jesus, send the Holy Spirit here. And if we got him, we can take authority over it. Let's look at one more scripture here. Mark 16. You think, well, I don't know about that, Jerry. I don't know if I'm going to do all this. Okay.
Say, Lily and Sparrow, y'all are at school, and some girl's saying they're having nightmares at school. You want me to show you what the Bible says do? Right here it says, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. But listen to this. It says, and these signs will follow those who believe. In my name they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Now, you ain't got to mess with no snake. But if you do, claim that scripture. But look right back there. It says they will cast out demons. There's demons come that make it's a spirit of fear. I used to have this stuff on me. I'm telling you, it was demonic. I remember coming up here playing, and right after I got saved, and I'd be like, this overwhelming anxiety. And there's another guy here, that he's passed on now. And he's like, man, I got to where I can't even hardly come in here. He said, it's just so overwhelming anxiety. And I was up there, and me and Jeff was about the only one playing. I was up there playing. I was all, oh, no, I'm going to mess up. Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm telling you, that's the way I was feeling, just overwhelming, just didn't know what. It was like demonic. And then finally, it's like I felt like the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, if you fall off that drum stool, they might be, out of the 12 people in here, three of them might see it in life. But they don't, nobody going to care or nothing about it if you mess up or not. Why are you feeling this? And I started realizing, why am I feeling afraid? Why am I feeling overwhelmed? Why am I feeling this anxiety? And then I started realizing it was a spirit. It was a demonic spirit. And when I realized that, and I started praying, I said, Lord, I want the Holy Spirit. I want this stuff gone. And I quit accepting that that's just the way I was. I needed to go get some Xanax. You know what I'm saying? I'm telling you, the Lord will set you free and totally free. I'm telling you, this is real. This stuff is real. But I'm telling you, who's more powerful? It's the Holy Ghost. There's no reason to be. There's no fear in God. There's no fear in Jesus. You can get up here and talk, or you talk to somebody or whatever. You ain't got to be afraid. It's a spirit. I've seen drug addiction. Same way with me. I felt an overwhelming. After I got saved and I was on cloud nine, and I had a bonfire that night. I burned all my stuff where I knew it wouldn't be. I thought, well, if I burn it all that way, I won't be tempted to do it no more. You know, so if I'm going to set it on fire. And I remember I had some digital scales, and I was sitting there looking, and I thought, man, I can sell them for $100. You're like, something, burn them. So I just broke them over my knee and threw them in the fire. I said, Lord, Lord. You know, and I felt, I mean, I was so happy that night. I was, come back to the Lord, and He accepted me, forgave me. Remember, Clyde, that night you were saying he forgave you from stuff that you'd done? Clyde was up here. He's like, he forgave me. He did forgive me. Well, that's the way I was that night. He forgave me, and I loved him, and I felt the presence of God. And then I was on cloud nine that week. I ended up going, this is a long time ago, and I went and got married, and I shouldn't have, but I went and got married that week to do everything right and everything. And then I was on, anyway, I went to work the trailer plant, got my first check. They handed it to me. I'd done work for 2 weeks, and I got my first check. I walked out just feeling just like everything, and all of a sudden, boom, what is this? It's back. This thing's back. Yeah, why did I burn it? Why did I burn it? What am I going to do? I'm going to have to go hunt it and pay retail, and it ain't going to be no count. You know, this is what's going into my head. And then I was like, Lord, help me. And it's like, no, I'm burning because I don't want to go to hell. You know, they're going to people, if your name ain't written in the book, you're going to get thrown in the lake of fire. And I was praying. I said, Lord, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? And then it's, well, he'll forgive you one more time for old time's sake. And then it's like, and then I thought, I know that wasn't me because I knew. I was like, I ain't never done one thing, y'all can tell. I like donuts or whatever. Last night I did eat just one donut, but I was unfull on something else.
But anyway.
But I'm getting control of that in Jesus' name. But I'm telling you, That night, that day, and then when I felt that, and I went home, I was reading the Bible, and it was a demonic spirit that had me. Yeah, what was you going to say? Was you going to say something? Oh, okay. But anyway, the demonic spirit was had came on me, and when I never will forget, I said, Jeff, I said, I want you to go with me and invite a friend of mine to church. And we went over there. We invited him to church. We pulled out. And I said, I didn't think he'd come. But I said, I knew if I come over here and invited him to church, I'd be ashamed to come over here and hunt any dope. And when I did, I'm telling you, I felt it leave. I burnt that bridge. And then the next time I was on cloud nine again, I was back fired up for the Lord. And we came in the crossroads over here, and somebody said, I just keep struggling with pain bills. I said, I know what to do. They said, what? I said, call every doctor around here, tell them you're addicted to them, and you're going to get the DEA to set them up where they can't give no prescriptions if you give you another one. I ain't doing that. I said, no, that's what do. They want you. They ought to give you some Motrin. I bet you. Just do it. No, I don't know. I might need a pain pill. No. I'm telling you, you got to get real with it. You know what I'm saying? Get real with it. He'll get real with you. I'm telling you. I felt it leave, and I've been free ever since. And, you know, I can go on and on about spiritual stuff. But this Halloween, us don't do Halloween. Pray. Let's say Holy Ghost. The only ghost I'm wanting in the house is the Holy Ghost. You know what I'm saying? Yes. And I'm down here, too. And it said, I traded a garment of heaviness for I traded a spirit of heaviness for a garment of praise. See, I can't even remember them right neither. So. But I kind of got an idea of it. You know what I'm saying? Because it's kind of like, but it said a spirit. When it said a spirit, that's when Derek Prince said he traded a spirit of heaviness. That's like, oh, depression. For a garment of praise. When you say that shows it's a spirit. It's a demonic spirit of heaviness, depression. You say, how do I trade it for a garment of praise? Lord, thank you, Lord. Thank you for saving me, coming in my life, Lord. You're going to get me a good job. I might not have one right now, but it's coming. In the name of Jesus, I thank you, Lord. Begin to have an attitude of gratitude. That's what Hope says. If we was going to do something, she said, we always skate through Thanksgiving. She said, we would have just a big service, just have a Thanksgiving. And I think we might do that. Have people get up and thank the Lord for what they've done to them, what they've done for their family. And then we'll get up and Mike can put it on the internet. You know what I'm saying? I'm telling you. Say, what the Lord. We'll do that. We'll do it. We'll set a date in November before Thanksgiving. And if you want to share what the Lord's done for you, if we get so many, we'll just do it all day long. We'll do it that night, too. We'll just have Thanksgiving Day food. We'll have a big throwdown, huh? Yes. Lord loves us. And if we begin, I'm telling you, we need to get so close to him like Hope was doing about the sheep. We just talking about that bummer lamb. I pulled it up the other night, and I said, well, I don't want to listen to that part again. She said, well, that's the best part. When I pulled it up, she said, that's the best, the only part I was wanting to hear. And I said, well, I'm going to go to squalling again. We talking about that little bummer lamb. We all been bummer lambs, you know. And he loves us. And the little bummer lamb, the shepherd, would take it and hold it on his shoulder. That's why Jesus are. So if you get called a bummer lamb, that's a good thing. Praise God. Lord Jesus.